blessed our brothers, you have blessed our children. And we know that as the covenant, as the marriage, the miracle series continues, you are going to still bless us. Lord, as we want to center on all our children and young adults, we pray that none of us will be left out in your miracle power in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We pray that you will manifest yourself and manifest your power in our midst in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the miracle we all desire, you will give to every one of us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
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 If you are ready for miracle tonight, amen.
Amen.
I said, if you are ready for miracle tonight, amen.
Amen.
Tonight, as you can see on the screen, we're going to be concentrating on our children, young adults, and anybody that is yet to be married. We categorize them as minors, particularly all the people who are still underage. I mean, our children, our young adults who do not have, our youth, who do not have some rights accrued to them, either by the government, or they are not allowed to do some things by their parents. But tonight, God is recognizing them and is going to pour out his miracles upon them. But the kind of miracle we are going to be talking about is covenant miracles. Let's turn our Bible to Genesis chapter 17. In Genesis, if you have your Bible, can you just please turn your Bible to Genesis chapter 17 and from verse 4. We are told from verse 4 to 8, God is speaking here unto Abraham. If you go back to verse 1, and when Abraham was 90 years and 9, the Lord, you see, the Lord is the one speaking here. So in verse 4, the Lord said, as for me, behold, my covenant. He said, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name anymore be called Abraham, but thy name shall be called Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee, and I will cause, and I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee, and I will establish my covenant between thee, between me and thee, and thy seed. You have to pay attention, y'all, our children. Between me and thee, and thy seed after thee in their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto them, unto thee, and to thy seed after thee. In verse 8, and I will give unto thee and to thy seed after thee the land wherein thou art a stranger, or the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. If you pay attention here, these are heavy words. The verses we have read, they are so loaded with the promises of God and the covenant of God. And that's why it's so instructive that we look at this today. We look at the covenant that God wants to make with his children, the covenant God wants to make with us and our children. You know, if you know anything about covenant, you will see that covenant is beyond miracles. Many of us, we always take miracles to be limited to healing. That's what I'm trying to express there. The healing is actually, miracle is more than healing. It's beyond healing. Miracle include helps that you get unusual help from God. Miracle include that God change your heart. The natural heart of man, the Bible says, is wicked, is devilish, is stubborn. We are naturally bent towards evil. And if God can work in your heart such that your heart is now soft, such that your heart is now pure, that is miracle. If God can lift you from the dust of failure to the height of success, that is miracle. In fact, it's a covenant miracle. If God can grant you holiness, you and your household, that is covenant miracle. And if God can eventually take you home and take you to heaven, that is covenant miracle. In fact, if God is your God, that in itself is miracle, because some other people have stone as their God. They have trees as their God. They have, you know, whatever, anything you can name in India, they have thousands of gods. Anything can be a god. Water is a god. Air is a god. Leaf is a god. Just imagine that. But if you have the King of Kings as your God, that is covenant miracle. And we shall soon see as we continue. You know, the covenant miracle of God, they cover all the areas of our land. They cover our homes. They cover our Christian life. And they cover our church. We look, if you say cover our home, in fact, God was speaking to Abraham here, but actually that covenant extended to his wife, extended to his children. In fact, Ishmael had been born here. Look at verse 15. In verse 15 of Genesis chapter 17, verse 15. And God said unto Abraham, as for Sarai thy wife, thou shalt not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. Just imagine, God extended the covenant miracle to Sarah. That's the old. And imagine, after God changed the name of Abraham in verse 4, God himself, in his miraculous power, began to call Abraham by that new name. Tonight, God will change your name for a better. Mm-hmm. I mean, he will begin to call you by a new name. You know, mm-hmm. the covenant miracle of God, they cover our, you know, our Christian and our church. You see, God's covenant with his people is unique and full. God makes us to become. If you look at verse 4, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be. That word be is the word to become. God makes us to become in the covenant. He makes us in the covenant. He said, I will desist, and I will make thee. Do you see? God makes us become in the covenant. He gives us in the covenant. In verse 8, and I will give thee. I will give unto thee. God gives us in the covenant, and God becomes our God in the covenant. In the latter part of verse 8, and I will be their God. What a wonderful God we serve. He wants his covenant with us and our generation to be ever. What do I mean by ever? That covenant, God wants it to be everlasting. God wants it to be ever full. God wants it to be ever fresh. God wants it to be ever including our generation, including our wife, including our husband, including our children, ever possessed. He wants us to say, for an everlasting possession. He wants us to possess that covenant. His plan is that his covenant with us are possessed by us and passed down to our children. Remember in Isaiah chapter 8, in verse 18, as for me and my children, you know, not only, just on your Bible, in Isaiah, in chapter 8, you see, God wants that covenant to be passed down to our children. Whatever covenant God is giving you, he does not want that covenant to stop with you. He wants the blessing in the covenant to be passed down to your generation. In Isaiah chapter 8, in verse 18, Isaiah chapter 8, verse 8, says, behold, I and the children whom the Lord had given me are for signs and wonders in Israel from the Lord. You know, you just imagine, God wants that covenant to be possessed by us and passed down to our generation, our minors, our children. You know, God's covenant is the only foundation of our hope. Just imagine, if God did not have covenant with Abraham, where will his hope lie? How will he give back to children? How will he become fathers of many generations? How will he become the father of the faithful? God's covenant, if there's anything you want to make your life unique in this earth, make covenant with God, or allow God to make covenant with you. And that covenant will not be established for you, and it will be established for your generation. God is so good, and that's why we all must make up our mind to have covenant with our God. Our God want to make covenant with us, and therefore we want to want his covenant to be established for us. Amen.
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 We look at 3 points in our message. Number one, the covenant of manifold miracles. Number two, true covenant minus for manifestation. Number three, timeless crowning miracles for minors. We look at points number one. In point number one, the covenant of manifold miracles. You know, in Genesis chapter 17, turn your Bible with me. In Genesis chapter 17, in verse 4, just look at it. When you say manifold, it means variety. It means many. It means plenty. It means full. God is not just making a one covenant with him. When God says, I want to make a covenant with you, In fact, the content of the covenant are manifold, are many. In fact, you know, just imagine God has actually made covenant when he called him in chapter 12. God made a covenant with him, but now he had expanded the covenant. And that's the ability of God. He expands the covenant. He gives more content into the covenant. Just, you know, look at it in Genesis chapter 17, in verse 4. He said, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Amen. In verse 5, neither shall thy name anymore be called Abraham, but thy name shall be called Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee. You see, God's renewed encounter with Abraham resulted in an enlarged covenant with a change of name. That change of name actually emphasized Abraham's worldwide mission as God's representative to the peoples of the world. Just imagine that Abraham, you know, the effect of the life of Abraham actually transcend all generation, transcend all nation. Because of that covenant, he said, I will make thee the father of many nations. Our God is good. And when God makes covenant with us, his covenant is great. Let's break this part into three parts. Number one, we look at covenant giver of redeemed people. We look at covenant gift of the revived, renewed people. And lastly, we're going to look at confirmation and glory of reigning people. You know, God actually confirmed his miracle as he made them. Let's look at the first aspect of this point, the covenant giver of redeemed people. You know, you and I know that Abraham was redeemed. In fact, he was redeemed from the eye of the Chaldean. He was redeemed from a life of idolatry. He was redeemed from following idols, the dead idols. And he began to follow the Lord. Now, the Bible says God has told Abraham to leave his father's house, and Abraham obeyed, not knowing where he was going. And that obedience became unique. And that obedience and that faith obedience was counted for righteousness for Abraham. But let's look at it. Who is this covenant giver? Can we meet him? Can we know him? Can we receive from him? Can our children be blessed by him? You know, before we begin to talk about how our children can benefit, how can we benefit? How can we also reiterate the covenant, the manifold covenant God has made with us? God, the covenant giver of redeemed people. God is not only a law giver. That's how many people know him. But he is but a benevolent covenant giver. We should rejoice that our God is a God of covenant, covering our lives and land. That is, God's covenant covers every areas of our life, and it covers every areas where we are living. And that's why there is safety in that covenant. That's why there is protection in that covenant. That's why there is security in that covenant. But in what way can we see God as this covenant, you know, covenant God, a covenant giver? Turn your Bible with me to Deuteronomy in chapter 5. Deuteronomy chapter 5. Let's look at that. Our God is a fearless covenant-making God. There are many people that are afraid to make covenant. No, that's not God. God can make covenant. And when he make covenant, he stand by the covenant. Our God is a fearless covenant-making God. In Deuteronomy chapter 5. Deuteronomy chapter 5. Oh. In Deuteronomy chapter 5. In verse 2 and 3, just pay attention to the wordings of the word of God. In Deuteronomy chapter 5, in verse 2 and 3, and the Lord our God made, you see that word, made a covenant with us in Horeb. He's a covenant-making God. The Lord made not that covenant with our fathers, but with us, even us, who are all of us, yet alive this day. Just look at that word. He said, God makes covenant. He is a covenant-making God. He's a fearless covenant. He's not afraid. He's not going to say, you are going to exhaust all my kindness. Therefore, I cannot make covenant with you. I have made covenant with Abraham. I cannot make covenant with you. No, God's riches are inexhaustible. God's wealth are inexhaustible. God's money are inexhaustible. Anything God has is infinite, is inexhaustible. And therefore, if the whole world is 20 billion, God can make covenant with each individual. And his covenant can supply all the needed requirement to fulfill that covenant with that person. So our God is a fearless
covenant-making God. And that's why he's the covenant giver of redeemed people. And therefore, you want to look at your life. Do I have covenant with God? Number two, God is a faithful covenant-keeping God. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, in verse 9, our God is a covenant-keeping God. In verse 9 of Deuteronomy chapter 7, we are told, "Now know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God." Amen. He said, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandment to 1,000 generations. Look at the revelation of the word of God here. The Bible says God is a faithful covenant keeping God. You know, we are talking about covenants for our minors. We need to remind ourselves so that our children can hear this, that the God we serve, that they can develop interest to serve our God. The God whom we serve is the faithful covenant-keeping God. And if you are a parent here, make covenants with God. And if you have made covenants with God, not encourage your children to sustain that covenant, renew that covenant, and make covenants with God. Our God is a fulfilling, faultless, covenant performing God. You know, when God makes covenant, he swears to an oath, so to speak. He makes promises in the covenant, but he does not only make promises, he has the power to perform. In Romans chapter 4, our God is a covenant performing God. He's a fulfilling covenant performing God. In Romans chapter 4, turn your Bible with me to Romans chapter 4, in verse 21. To see that our God fulfills and performs his covenant. In Romans chapter 4, in verse 21, Romans chapter 4, verse 21, we are told, "And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform." Look at our God, our covenant giver. He does not only give covenant, he performs the oath and the content of the covenant. And therefore, we want to love him more. Because our God is a covenant performing God. Let's look at the second aspect of this, you know, point one, the covenant gift of revived and renewed people. Why do we say that? Because Abraham had been revived here. You know, is your life going down? God cannot enlarge the covenant he had for you until you are renewed. And thank God we have gone through revival series. And we have had messages that our pastor gave. Not to bring us to revival, because when you are in revival, that's when God can enlarge his covenant with you. And that's why God was able to enlarge his covenant with Abraham, because Abraham had become revived. Look at it in chapter 17, verse 1. Look at it. Holiness, you know, is revival. Look at it in chapter 17, verse 1. "And when Abraham was 90 years old and nigh, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect." So God called him to perfection. And because God called him to perfection, and you know Abraham, he always responds. Whatever God tells Abraham, that's why God loves Abraham. That's why he's the friend of God. God also is calling you. He's calling you to say, walk before me in your attitude. Walk before me in your devotion. Walk before me in your service to God. Walk before me in your heart and be thou perfect. It's only when you come to that renewal, it's only when you come to that revival that the covenant gift can be yours. Because after God called Abraham to renewal, after God called Abraham to revival, after God called Abraham to righteousness, and Abraham responded, God enlarged the covenant. You know, if you, the original covenant in chapter 12, compare it to this covenant in chapter 17, you discover it is an enlarged covenant. God wants to enlarge his covenant with you, but you must respond to the call of revival. You must respond to the call of renewal. You must respond to the call of righteousness. God called Abraham, but let's look at the content of that covenant. We call it the covenant gift of revived and renewed people. And that's why you are included in this one. That God wants to revive you and he wants to enlarge his covenant with, number one, you see, expanded full covenant. God expanded his covenant with Abraham. Look at it in chapter 4, in chapter 17, verse 4. "As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name anymore be called Abraham, But thy name shall be called Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee. God explained that in chapter 12. God didn't change his name, but he has the covenant. But now, after God had called him to renewal, after God had called him to revival, God expanded the covenant for Abraham. He changed his name to reflect the blessing God had destined for his life. You know, God said, you are going to be a father of many nations. But I want to, I want to expand your name. You know, Abraham means exalted father. God said, no, you are just exalted, but I want to make you the father of multitude. That's the meaning of Abraham, the father of multitude. Not just multitude of men, but multitude of nations. Amen. Is it God expanded? But if you read chapter verse 4 again, you will observe something here. You will observe covenant with. But that word, we have met it before in the Bible. Emmanuel, God with us, Christ with us. You know, that's it. Covenant with thee, Christ with us. And you have also made that in the relation to the what? To the Holy Spirit. He said, the Comforter, he shall be with you and he shall be in you. Do you now see that the Trinity, they take part in this covenant? Covenant with thee, Christ with thee, and Comforter with it. Let's look at that part of the covenant, because we are familiar with that part of Emmanuel, Christ with us. Look at in John chapter 14. In John chapter 14, turn your Bible to see the Comforter with thee, to show you how the Trinity is involved in almost everything. In John chapter 14, in verse 16, he said, and I will pray the Father, remember covenant, and he shall give thee another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Remember, the covenant is, the intention of the covenant is to be with you forever. He said, your Comforter will be with you forever. That's just an addendum for you to observe that the covenant with, that Christ with, and the Comforter with. You know, God in the covenant, what is another gift in that covenant? God said, I will make you exceptional father. Can you imagine? Somebody that is the father of multitude, that's exceptional. Somebody that is the father of many nations. That is not, men can only be identified with one nation. That's why, if you go to South Korea, North Korea, America, they can identify a man with a nation. But God said, for Abraham, I will identify you with many nations. God made him exceptional father. In Genesis chapter 17, in verse 4, he said, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Look at the gifts in that covenant. Another thing that you can see in that covenant is an excellent fresh name. You know, from that time that God changed the name of Abraham, nobody in the old earth called Abraham by his former name. You know, that is the power of God. The name became an household name. You know, where in the world you mentioned Abraham, everybody will remember, Abraham, blessings are mine. God gave him an excellent, fresh name. And that's what God does. God always changed people's name. He changed their name to reflect the miracle that he wants to do in their life. You know, God also said, I'm going to make thee exceedingly fruitful. Exceedingly fruitful. That is so unique. Look at it. In verse 5. In verse 6. And I will make thee exceeding fruitful. Imagine that. That's another gift in the covenant. And that's the same thing God is talking to you about. That he wants to make you exceeding fruitful. Only God can do that. No man can do that. No science can do that. No, God said, look at the star Abraham, and if you can count it, so shall thy seed be. Thy seed will not operate on the land alone. They will operate in the sky. They will operate in the heavenly. They will be like stars. God said, I will make thee exceeding fruitful, exceeding fruitfulness and fruit. God also said in the seas, he said, I will make nations of thee. That is, nations shall come out of thee. And that is exemplary father of many nations. God said, I will make nations out of thee. He said, I will not, nations shall come out of thee. And all the nations that came out of Abraham, they were not weak nations. They were powerful nations. Some of them are, you know, persecuting Israel now, no thanks to that. But yet, to just to tell you that the nations that came out of Abraham, they were energized, fresh nations from Abraham. You know, let Abraham later marry Keturah. You know, Esau, there is a nation that came out of Esau. There is a nation that came out of Ishmael. There is a nation that came out of Isaac. There is a nation that came out of the children of Keturah. And some other women that Abraham later married. Then he knows that energized nations came out of Abraham. God also said, kings shall come out of Abraham. Imagine that they were exalted and 45 kings that came out of Abraham. Can you remember David? Was he a weak king? Can you remember Hezekiah? Was he a weak king? Can you remember the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ, coming out of the seed of Abraham? In fact, they were exalted and 45 kings that came out of, you know, the Lord also told him, in that covenant, he said God gave him an exact fruitful land. God mentioned it. Look at it in verse 7. In verse 8. And I will give unto thee and to thy seed after thee the land. You know, God was, all the other blessings were concerning life. But now, the Lord now said the land. The Lord mentioned the land specifically. And that's what God wants to do for us. When God makes covenant with you, he is specific. And whenever you are making covenant with God, be specific. God said, the land of Cana. And what can you remember about the land of Cana? A land flowing with milk and honey. You know, God said, all the blessing I've given you is not, it will not be short-lived. It's an everlasting possession. In verse 8, for an everlasting possession. And lastly, God said, I will be eternal father and God to you and your children. The same thing, God, you know, God wants to renew our heart as parents before we begin to talk about our children, that the covenant of God is, you know, the crowning beauty of the covenant of God is that God is our heavenly father. God is want to be a father unto us so that we can be, you know, we can be sons and daughters. But you must observe that God does not only make covenant, he confirms the covenant. That the third part of this point one is the confirmation and glory of his reigning people. Look at it in Genesis chapter 17, in verse 15. If you read that to chapter 12, from verse 15 to 21, you see God began to confirm the covenant. You know, when God confirmed his covenant, he confirmed the covenant as he has said them. Look at it in Genesis chapter 21, in verse 1. Genesis chapter 21, in verse 1. He confirmed and performed his covenant as he has said them. In Genesis chapter 21, he said, and the Lord visited Sarah as he had said. So when God said, I'm making covenant with you, I will make you president. Go and write it down. You will not become mayor. You will not become vice president. You will become the exact thing God has said you will become. If God said, you know, he said, fear not, little. He said, it is thy father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. God will not give you anything less. He said, the Bible said, as he has said. And that's how our God is a faithful God. And that's how we can keep covenant with him. The Bible tells us, and the Lord visited Sarah as he has said. Imagine that. Look at it. God did not confirm his covenant as he has said. God confirmed his covenant at the set time. If God said tomorrow, you'll be this, you just go and settle down, it will be like that. Remember Elisha, he gave that prophecy. By this time tomorrow, a cup of this and that, it was like that as God has said. And that's why we can rely on this God. Now look at it in verse 2. Genesis chapter 21, verse 2. For Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age at the set time, of which the Lord has spoken to him at the set time. Now, when God not give you a covenant, he confirms it as he has said. Number two, he performs it and confirms it at the set time. And when God do it, he also not confirm it as he has shown them. God showed Abraham that his children will be stars. Did God confirm that? Of course he confirmed that. know, when you are star, you are in the highest position. Can you remember Joseph, the star? Can you remember, you know, can you remember David, the star? Can you remember Paul the Apostle, the star? Can you remember Peter, the star? Can you remember Daniel and his friends, the star? So when God was showing Abraham, he was showing him and he will confirm it as he had shown them. Remember, when God even showed Balaam, that false prophet, so to speak, he later became false prophet. You know, he said, the shout of king is among them as he has shown them. And God sustained his covenant from generation to generation. If you read Luke chapter 1, verse 72 to 75, the Bible tells us, you know, the oath and the covenant which he had made with our father, God sustained it to the New Testament. God sustained the covenant unto our own time. And that's our God is a faithful God. Let's look at point number two, the true covenant, not the true minors for manifestation. You know, tonight's message is miracle for our minors. But we have reminded ourselves that the covenant our parents are carrying, the covenant we want to pass to our children, is a covenant with manifold miracles. And therefore, our children can trust in the covenant of God. They need not go and look for other God, but they must actually do something for them to become true covenant minors that will manifest all the content God has highlighted. Esau was not a true covenant minor. He disobeyed his parents. He did not love God. And you can begin to mention a lot of people in the line of Abraham that were not true covenant minors. But we know today, we want to not think about this. We believe our children are listening. We believe our parents can take home a number of things that our, you know, our children need to do a number of things for them to become true covenant, God's covenant, which is renewed people is great, gracious, and generational. His providential plan is for us, for our children and for our minors. Minors who want the covenant blessing and miracles to continue with them must activate and accept the covenant by faith. Abraham, before God began to make covenant with him, he had faith. And if our children, we know it's not alone for them to have the covenant that is, you know, the covenant is there over their life, but they must activate it by faith. Let's look at three aspects of this point two. Number one, mercy and conversion to become true covenant minors. Mercy and conversion to become true covenant minors. Number two, the miraculous capacity of transform and conquering minors. And we look at the third part of point two, mirroring the commitment for transmission of covenant miracles. Let's look at one. That what are the things our children need to do so that they can enjoy and become part of this covenant? Our parents may not have this covenant. Our children may enjoy, but the true rich and the real covenant will never be enjoyed until they are converted. You know, conversion. God had to do conversion in the, you know, conversion in the life of Abraham before he began to enjoy the mercy and the miracles of God. Look at it in chapter 17 of Genesis. Chapter 17 of Genesis, in verse 1, and Abraham, when Abraham was 99, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God, walk before me and be thou perfect. That's a requirement to be included and to not to enjoy the covenant of God. Look at chapter 18, in verse 19. Chapter 18, verse 19. Chapter 18, verse 19. For I know him, God was not bearing witness for Abraham, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he has spoken of him. Parents, may we pay attention that for us to remember the program of God is for us to pass the covenant to our children. But we must tell them, we must command them, we must instruct them, we must teach them. If we want the perpetuity and the continuity of the covenant with our generation, with our minors, with our children, we must command them in the way of the Lord. Now, for them to enjoy this covenant, what are the things that must happen to number one? There must be a change of nature. And that can only happen by repentance and faith. In Acts chapter 3. In Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3 in verse 19. We are told, repent ye therefore and be converted. Look at that word, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, when the covenant is to be fulfilled. God wants to meet you changed. God wants to meet you converted. So there must be a change of nature for you to enjoy the covenant. You know, minors, if you are here, our children, if you are listening, and I believe you are listening, if you want to enjoy the manifold miracles in the covenant, you must repent and believe the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two, there must be a change of name. Not necessarily in the change of our name. If your name is Michael, that's a good name. If your name is Peter, that's a good name. Not necessarily mean a change of your natural name, but God wants your spiritual name to be changed. When you are not born again, you are called a sinner. When you are not born again, you are called children of the devil. But when you become born again, your name changed to become a saint. Your name changed to become children of God. The Bible says now you are the children of God. You are the children of God. Look at it in Isaiah chapter 62. Isaiah chapter 62 in verse 2. Isaiah chapter 62. Look at the promise of God there. Isaiah chapter 62 in verse 2. The Bible says, and the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory, and thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. Let God name you. Let God name you the righteousness of God. Kings, if you are listening, let God name you. You know, not necessarily mean changing your natural name that your parents who believe in the Lord, those names are covenant name. Those names are great name. But God wants to change your spiritual name. A sinner, you know, every individual is spiritual. But now it depends on whose side you are. Whether you are spiritual on the side of God or you are spiritual on the side of Satan. But once you become born again, you are translated, you know, spiritual from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of his dear son. And there is a change of spiritual name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. And after you have done that, there will be a covenant nothing. There will be the reaching out and the falling before God as Abraham did to show our submission and acceptance. But what can we do for this covenant to be ours? We are told in John chapter 1 verse 12, our minors, our children need to receive, to accept the Lord in their life. They need to receive him. They need to receive the Lord Jesus Christ for that covenant to be activated, for that covenant, for them to participate in the covenant of God. In John chapter 1 in verse 12. Turn your Bible with me to John chapter 1 in verse 12. John chapter 1. Look at it in verse 12. He said, but as many as received him, the Lord Jesus Christ, to them he gave power, authority, right, to become. You remember we made that word, to, I will make it to be, to become the sons of God, even to them that believe in his name. So he said, if you want to become partakers of this generational covenant, you must receive it. So our children today, you must receive the Lord. Our parents must remind them that there must be mercy and conversion before our children can become true covenant minors. And the Lord is saying, the Lord wants to do it. But there's something more. After our children have become converted, there is something much more. There is an enlarged covenant to our children also. There is a capacity in the covenant for our children to become great. In Genesis chapter 17, in verse 6, look at what God said, the children of Abraham will become. In Genesis chapter 17, in verse 6, and I will make thee exceeding fruitful. That implies his children will be fruit. They will move from seed, they will become fruit. That's great. You know, when you see a tree, you don't go for the seed, you go for the fruit. No, God said that our children, inside that covenant, it means our children will live long. Before your life can become fruitful, it means you have longevity. You know, the Lord implied that in this. He said, I will you, and I will make nations of thee. You know, remember, how did they become nations? They had names. Isaac, later children became Israel, and that's a nation. Esau later became a nation, Edom. So there was the movement of from name to nation. And the Lord said that, look at it in verse 6. They create capacity in our children. In verse 6, and kings that come out of thee. How did they become kings? They were kings, and they became kings. You now see the capacity the Lord is saying, that there is a great capacity for God to do this in our children. That our children that we are looking at, they have great covenant capacity in them. From seed, they will become fruit. Now they will give people joy. They will be used by God to be blessing to many generations. And from their name, how many of us know that our children carry the capacity to become nation? Whatever name you call them, if they are part of the covenant of God, they will move from name to nation, and they will move from kids to kids. Brethren, do you know that in Christ, we have all these three fulfilled? In Christ, we have all these three fulfilled, from seed to fruit, from names to nation, from kids to kings. Look at it. Jesus Christ implied that in John chapter 12, in verse 24. In John, in chapter 12, John chapter 12, in John chapter 12, in verse 24. John chapter 12, verse 24. He said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a corn of wheat. He's talking about the seed. He said, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, he bringeth forth much fruit. In Christ, you know, he was talking about the consecration. He was talking about we must make our life a seed for it to become a fruit. The Lord is saying that the covenant is in Christ. The covenant has been actually been transferred from Abraham, and the cruise of the covenant is with Christ. And that's what the Bible said. No, the Bible was not talking about that in Romans and in Galatians. He said he was not talking about seeds in plural as of many, but he was talking about the seed, singular, as of Christ. That the whole covenant, when God was making that covenant, his eyes was actually on Christ. That the culmination of the covenant was to be in Christ. And everything that you can realize in Abraham, you can get it in Christ. So don't say, oh, I was not directly born by Abraham. If you give your life to Jesus Christ, all those covenant miracles and blessings will be yours. Look at it in 1 Peter, in chapter 2, verse 9. In 1 Peter, in chapter 2, verse 9. In 1 Peter, in chapter 2, in verse 9. 1 Peter, chapter 2, verse 9. He said, but ye are a chosen generation. Remember, we met that word, a royal priesthood, kings. We met that word, an holy nation. You see, in Christ, we become nation. And that's why you want to be part of the church. That's why you want to become part of the body of believers. Because we are nation. We are a holy nation. What about kings? In Revelation, in chapter 1, verse 6. In Christ, we realize that. And that's our children need to be born again. And when they become born again, there is a double dealing, double dose of God's covenant miracle operating in their life. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 6, we are told, and he had made us kings. That was part of the covenant. But you will not realize that if you are not part of Christ. If you don't give your life to Jesus Christ. He said, he had made us kings. He had made us kings. And that's why, you know, everything is realized in Christ. What, you know, what can our children do to sustain this covenant? Number three, there should be that mirroring, the commitment for transmission of covenant miracles. Our children will not just sit akimbo or sit with their hand folded and say, well, God had made covenant with my parents, therefore, I will enjoy it all the same. Remember, that was the attitude of Esau, but he never got the covenant. That was the attitude of so many people in the line of Abraham. They never got the real miracle. That was the attitude of Saul, the first king of Israel. He never got the miracle, the covenant miracle, never continued with his lineage. So what can we do? We must mirror their commitment for transmission of covenant miracles. Look at it in Genesis chapter 17. In the 7,
and I will establish my covenant. Remember, you look at that word. I will establish my covenant between thee, between me and thee, and thy seed after thee. What was God saying here? God is not saying that covenant is a standalone covenant. Once I made it with Abraham, that is fine. He said, as your children come, as your generation come, I will continue to make that covenant with them. And that was why God made that covenant with Isaac. It was a repetition. God made that covenant with Jacob. It was a repetition. God made that covenant with David. It was a repetition and a love. God made that covenant with Jesus, a repetition and a love. So our youth need to come to God to enjoy that real covenant. Then he also to come and make covenant with our God. Parents must tell them this, that they must mirror the commitment of these fathers for transmission of covenant miracles. Look at it. What? How can they do this? No, Abraham was the lead in that covenant. And all his children came from him. So let's see, what can we mirror in Abraham and all his children to be going to perpetuate and continue that covenant miracle? In Abraham, we saw absolute obedience, acceptable fear, and instant faith of Abraham. So for our children to continue the transmission of the covenant miracle, they must mirror absolute obedience to God. They must mirror acceptable fear to God. They must mirror instant faith to God. They must mirror the brokenness and devotion to God of Jacob. Jacob was devoted to God, and that was why his eyes was on the covenant, because he made mistakes. But yet, he was devoted to God compared to Esau, who did not have any fear for God. So our children, for them to continue that covenant, there must be brokenness with our God. There must be devotion to our God. What about the reliance prayer and total submission of Isaac? They must mirror that. In fact, that covenant of fruitfulness was not immediately fulfilled in the life of Isaac, in his family. What did Isaac do? Isaac went to pray and said, God, you made this covenant of exceeding fruitfulness. And God said, oh, I remember. And God opened the womb of Rebecca, and Rebecca gave birth to twins. Imagine when Isaac reminded God, God gave him a double blessing. If your children can also model that and say, God, you made covenant with my father, you made covenant with my mother, that covenant is not fulfilled in my life. And when you go to God, God will give you double. God gave Isaac double. So our children must mirror that reliance prayer and total submission of Isaac. What about a firm purpose of heart and uncompromising stand of Daniel and his friend? If our children want the perpetuity and the continuity of the covenant, they must mirror that purpose of heart. The Bible says Daniel purposed in his heart that he will not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat. So he did not defile himself. So we must mirror that affirmed purpose of heart and uncompromising stand of Daniel and his friend. We must mirror heart full of fear of God and holiness of Joseph and Hezekiah. You know, those are the people that are in the lineage, and they continue the covenant. We must mirror that if we want to continue to enjoy the covenant of God. We must mirror the affection and the adoration to God of David, the sweet psalmist of Israel. The Bible says, man, after the heart of God, remember, he was in the lineage of Abraham. You know, Abraham had, he had children in his loins before those children came on land. He had them in his loins before they came on land. And therefore, we must mirror all the good things in their life for us to enjoy that covenant. Remember, Jesus, the Messiah, was also from that land. We must mirror his life. What is in his life? He said he must mirror his meat. Our meat may be Dunkin' Donuts. Our meat may be whatever we are eating. But Christ said there is a special meat I have doing the will of God. He said my meat is to do the will of God. We must mirror that if we want to enjoy the perpetuity and the continuity of the covenant miracle. We must mirror his mind. Let his mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. We must mirror his mission to seek and to save that which was lost. The summertime has come. We must mirror both our children, the minors, and all the members of the church. We must mirror the meat of Christ. We must mirror the mind of Christ. We must mirror the mission of Christ for us to continue to enjoy the miracle
God wants to give us. And I pray that the good Lord will give us that miracle, not only for us, for all our minors in Jesus' name. Before we pray, we go to point number three, the timeless crowning miracles for our minors. You know, we must not miss this out. That God crowned up that covenant he made with Abraham with something that was special. He said, I will be your God. If you have God, one with God is a majority. If you have God, you have everything. Give me Jesus and take away the whole world. Look at what the psalmist said before we look at that point and pray. In Psalm 73, that's the crowning timeless miracles for our minors. In Psalm 73 in verse 25, he said, whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon the earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Let's not look at the miracle. Let's look at the Almighty God. Brethren, let's not look at the covenant giver. Let's look at the covenant giver. Just imagine what the Bible is saying is here. He said, God is my portion forever. That is the crowning jewel I want forever. But look at this. He said, but no, they that are far from thee shall perish. Our children, will you listen? If you reject our God, you will perish. If you snuff our God, you will perish. If you reject our God, our covenant God, you will go to hell. You have a sorrowful life on earth. And therefore, the crowning miracle for all our minors is God himself. God is the timeless crowning miracle of all his people and all their generation. To have and possess God is the best and the greatest gift. Let's divide this aspect into three also. Number one, the divine miraculous placement in the land. The duration of matchless possession in their life. And the deity of our minor is the person of the Lord. Let's look at number one, the divine miraculous placement in the land. God is saying that if you accept me as the miracle covenant giver and you come into that covenant relationship with me, I will place you in this land. What a miracle that God said, I will place our children in strategic places. Look at it in chapter 17, verse 8. He said, and I will give thee and thy seed after thee the land. The land. God is talking about placement. If you read Ezekiel chapter 37 in verse 14, he said, oh my people, I will place thee in the land. God wants to place our children. That is part of the covenant. He wants to place them. So now when God talks about placing them, he not just want to place them, but that placement comes with other enviable benefits. Number one, there is the secure placement. When he places them, he will not make them separated peculiar minors, peculiar people. After he has placed them, you want to give them and make them stars. There is the stardom promise. There is the spiritual pattern. He wants to make them the spiritual pattern. Remember, a holy generation, a holy people, that other people will see our children as pattern to follow. And you know, because they're making progress, your life will be able to follow them. There is the strategic positioning. All the miracle to place our children strategic places in this world, in this America. He said there'll be strategic positioning, there'll be sure presence. It's not just the sure presence of God. Our children will not just be placed and nobody notice them. There'll be that certain and sure presence. There is that superlative progress for our children. There is that spectacular. You know, they want to make them spectacular. They will be spectacular and they will be peculiar. You also want to be a special planting. Say, children, they will be planted of the Lord. There will be specific possession and they will be surrounded protection. There is a warding of fire that is around our children. There is a wall of fire. There is the wisdom. There is the weapon. There is the watchful eyes of God over our children. God wants to do that. So that by his grace and mercy, our children can become what God wants them to be. Let's look at the second aspect of this part. The duration of matchless possession in their land. Consider there'll be that duration. He said, for an everlasting possession. In chapter 17, look at it in this. And they said it again. You know, towards the end, he said, for an everlasting possession. He's saying that every child, the miracle I'm going to give your minors, I'm going to give everyone, is for everlasting. But that's the plan of God. There is the plan of longevity of the miracle. But there must be a prayer for a long life manifestation for that miracle. In fact, you know, you see, there was a prayer that was prayed in Isaiah chapter 63, that the blessing of the Lord is shortly. In Isaiah chapter 63, in verse 18, Isaiah chapter 63, in verse 18, we're told, the people of thy holiness are possesses but a while. Why should we possess the covenant miracle for a while? And that's why there is a prayer for long, lifelong manifestation. You want to pray, parents, for your children, that they will not possess the covenant and the blessing of God for a while. Look at the lamentation here. He said, the people of thy holiness, the people of thy covenant, they are possessing for a while. But that is not the will not end on your life. It will perpetuate and continue in your children. And also, there is the promise of long life for our minors. We are familiar with that. The Lord said there will be long life. In fact, intrinsic in all the covenant, in all the content of the covenant, is long life. In Psalm 91, the plan of God, in Psalm 91, verse 16, with long life will I satisfy thee and show thee my salvation. That is the plan of God, that with long life, he will satisfy us and our children. And that will be our portion in Jesus' name. Before we pray, this is the most interesting part of this message tonight, that our God is the greatest covenant miracle we can have. Look at it in chapter 17, the latter part of verse 8. And I will be their God. I will be their God. Brethren, this is so important and critical, that God has elected to be the God of our children. We must challenge them that they must never choose another God. It comes with a high price. It does not only come with the price of going to hell, it comes with the price of a miserable life here on earth. And therefore, we must tell them, God, that we have, you know, just imagine all other people. People in the opposite religion, if their children there become Christian, they can kill that child. Just imagine people that know that worship another God. If their children convert to another religion, they can kill that child. We are not going to kill our children, but we must tell them that God has already said he is our God. And also, you know, that's why the children of Israel, they kept suffering. They were going into idolatry repeatedly. They were suffering because this is the aspect of the covenant that is in the topmost of the heart of God. The most. He wants to be our God. He does not want us to choose any other God, nor our children choose any other God. Our children, if you are here listening to me, this is the best thing God wants you to hear, that God wants to be your God. That you must not choose any other God. The sport must not be your God. Female must not be your God. Soccer must not be your God. Money must not be your God. Career must not be your God. Yourself, your beauty, your talent, that what things God has given to you must not be your God. God declares he is and he wants to be our God and the God of our minors. Amen. I say amen to that. This is information. And we must pass that information to our children that you have only one God. You can never choose any other God. You are not permitted to choose any other God. You already have a God. And that God is the covenant God of heaven. This is inspirational. That our God is, that the God of heaven is our God. All other God, they are down below. In fact, some of them are in the lower part of the earth. Those of them that are glorified are the ones that are in the air. But our God is seated on the throne in the third heaven. No man can get there. In the Bible says, dwelling in the light, no man can approach unto. Brother, if there's anything I can do tonight, is to impress upon you and our children that our God, He is God. This is interesting. This is instructive. This is important because there are lots of prophets, the prophet and blessing and power with our God that He can pass down to us. And this is the impact and the impartation is great. And this is indoctrination. If you call it indoctrination, so be it, that our children have only one God, that we ourselves have only one God. God elected, look at it in Genesis chapter 17, verse 8 again, and I will be their God. And I will be their God. And if you're a child here, you have joined bad gang, you have joined all these, you know, girls, you know, on the internet, and you are in a church group, and they are now teaching you about the God of this, God of that, not trying to pollute your heart from our God. The Bible said, come out. Come out tonight. In 2 Corinthians, in chapter 6, 2 Corinthians, in chapter 6, in verse 17. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. And I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughter, says the Lord of hosts. God is saying, I want to be your God, and so be you. The deity of our minor is the person of the Lord. If God is truly our God, He wants us to obey Him. And to obey Him means we obey Him. We do what He commands. We become like Him. We exalt Him and praise Him. We yield to Him. And He wants us to ask Him. Remember, when Isaac discovered that the covenant miracle was not getting fulfilled in his life, he had to wait for 25 years. Isaac woke up and he went to God. And God gave him double. When you ask God, He will give you double. He asked God, He sought God, he know God. And if our children can know God, we are told in Daniel chapter 11, verse 32, the people that know their God, they shall be strong and do exploit. The Lord has challenged us today that our children can become part of the covenant blessing. But they must be told, we must inform them, we must inspire them, we must just say it in a way that it will be interesting to them. We must instruct them. Remember, I know Him. He will command His children. We must tell them the importance. We must impart it unto them. We must indoctrinate them because this is where the blessing lies. And I pray that the blessing of God will not only remain in our life, it will flow from our life to our generation, to our children. Remember, our children have that capacity, the capacity to move from seed to fruit, the capacity to move from their name to nation, and the capacity to move from kids to king. Let's bow down our heads and go to the Lord in prayer. The covenant miracle is with us and our children. Let's commit ourselves before the Lord. Let's renew our covenant with God. Remember, there's enough for God to enlarge His covenant with you. You must yield that thing that Abraham yielded. You know, when Abraham was 99, the Bible said the Lord called him, walk before me and be thou perfect. You want to renew that covenant with God. Is there anything lacking in your own life? You want to go to God like Isaac and say, God, look at all You said in the covenant. It's not getting fulfilled in my life and my children. Do as thou hast said. Let's commit ourselves to the hands of God. And if you're a minor here, you're a kid here, you're a child here, open your mouth and pray and be combatant. You know, mirror the commitment of Abraham and his good king so that you can perpetuate and continue the covenant. Let's open our mouth and pray and commit ourselves before the Lord and say, oh God, let the covenant be in my life. I present myself for renewal. I present myself for revival. I present myself for a total turnaround. I bring my mind up before You. I bring my kids before You. I bring my children before You. That the capacity in them will be released. That the capacity in my children will be released. That the capacity in my children will be released. The capacity of my children will be released. Open your mouth and pray.
My children, O God of heaven, Father, let them walk in Your way, O God.
Every blessing can be recovered in Christ. That covenant is not fulfilled in your life. Remember, you can recover all in Christ.
In the mighty name
you
of
can
Jesus.
Recover all in Christ.
God and
you want to be fruit? You can recover that in Christ. You want to be a nation? You can recover that in Christ. You want to be a king? You can recover that in Christ. Open your mouth and pray. Challenge your mind not to pray. Challenge yourself to pray. And the Lord will not take care of you and take care of our children.
Be ready, divine, oh God, to fulfill all your covenants, oh God, in Jesus' name. Lord, touch these children, oh God, as they have been groomed, as they have been nurtured in the way of the Lord, cause them, oh God, to walk in your way and to bless you, oh God, in Jesus' name. Every spirit that may want to hijack the life of our children, oh Lord, Father, we subdue them in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Every power, principality that may want to come against our children, that we not make them to walk in your way. That may not make
the
them
covenant
to
of peace will be passed into our
children. With the sword in Jesus' name. Lord,
the covenant of long life will be passed into our children.
To our children. The peace of God will be in the life of this children. Lord, long life for these children.
The
name of Jesus.
That covenant with you will be extended. Let's call upon the name of the Lord and say, oh Lord, let that covenant transcend beyond me. The Lord wants to take that covenant beyond you. The Lord wants to take that covenant beyond you. Let's pray and call upon the name of the Lord. That, oh Lord, take that covenant beyond me. Take that covenant of peace beyond me. Take that covenant of mercy beyond me. All the things that the Lord wants to fulfill in your life, he doesn't want you to end it. He doesn't want you to end at your time. He wants you to take it beyond yourself. He wants to take that covenant of mercy beyond yourself. There is something that the Lord wants you to have, but he also wants you to take it beyond yourself. He wants you to pass it over to your children. And they want to pray that, oh Lord, if you had mercy on me and you saved me, you can save my children. If you had mercy on me and you brought me from the kingdom of darkness unto the kingdom of your dear son, you can also do it in the life of my children. Lord, if you are able to save me and to plant me in your own vineyard, you can also do it in the life of my children. Lord, I pray that the mercy that you have given me, you can also give it unto my children. Let's call upon the name of the Lord, that the Lord will take that covenant beyond you. If all the mercies that the Lord wants to give you is ending at you, you have not done well. If all the good things that the Lord, the spiritual benefits that the Lord has given you, if it is going to end with you, you have not done well. If all the things, the spiritual grace that the Lord has given you, that you are now a partaker and a citizen of the heavenly kingdom, if it is going to be only you and your children are going to be exempted, then you have not done well. And that is why I want to pray and call upon, oh Lord, remember our children. That is the kind of prayer you can pray tonight. Remember, you can mention their name. Remember my children. They must be covenant children. They might be covenant minors. They must be included in your everlasting covenant. That is the will of God. That is the desire of God. And that is what God wants to do in our life tonight. Let's call upon the name of the Lord, that your children will not be missed out in the kingdom of God. That your children will not be missed out in the covenant with the covenant-keeping God. Let's pray that, oh Lord, don't let them go. If it will take you dragging them into it, Lord, drag them into it. If it take you, Lord, pulling them into that covenant, Lord, pull them. They will not escape this. They will not escape this covenant. Let's pray that, oh Lord, you will touch them. Let's call upon the name of the Lord tonight and say, oh Lord, as many of our children who have run away, as many of our children who have traveled to the far country, as many of our children who have said that I don't want to do anything with the God of my fathers, with the God of women, wherever they are tonight, the Lord will bring them home. The Lord will bring them. Let's call upon the name of the Lord, that the Lord will bring them. None of our children will be missing in the kingdom of God. None of our children will be out of the covenant that the Lord has for us. He said that it is going to be an everlasting covenant. Let's call upon the name of the Lord.
point to go that our children will not be missed, God. In that covenant that you have made with us, you will establish.
And you make that confession tonight. My child, my son, my daughter will not be out of the kingdom of God. It depends on your prayer. If you are going to pray, if the Lord going to so much say that, I believe that this woman will command his children. I believe, I know that this woman will command his children. No matter the number of children that he has, none of them, be it 5 children, be it 10 children, none of them will escape in the kingdom of God. Can the Lord so much be of short and say that, as for you, I know, even I've given you, none of them will be lost in the kingdom of darkness. Let's pray, oh Lord, none of my children, mention their name to the Lord of God, mention their name to the covenant keeping God, mention their name to the Lord. Yes, my child, it might be a 1-year-old, it might be a 2-year-old, it might be a 3-year-old. You would say, oh Lord, that child will not be lost to the kingdom of darkness. He is a covenant God. He is a covenant child. He is a covenant man. He is going to be in the covenant relationship with the Lord. He will not forsake the God of his father. Oh, if Isaac has forsaken the God of Abraham, what will have been his son? If Jacob has forsaken the God of Isaac, what will have been his son? Oh Lord God, my child will not forget the God of his father. My daughter will not forsake the God of her father. In the mighty name of Jesus,
you will walk in the name of Jesus.
Them. Don't let them escape your grief to God. Don't let them escape. I commit them unto him. My brother, you can pray for your own child. My sister, you can pray for your own child. You can pray for the child that came out of your own loins. You want to pray that, oh Lord, these children, they will not be missing, oh God. They will not be missing. And let's pray that all our children, the blessings of Abraham will be upon them. The blessing that come out of that covenant that God had with Abraham. He said that, and the blessings of Abraham will be my blessing. We want to pray that every blessing that the Lord has commanded unto you as the father, unto you as the mother, it will trickle down. It will be a generational blessing. It should be a kind of blessing that the children will not, they will not struggle. They will not struggle in this land. They will not struggle in this land that they call the land of the free and the home of the brave. They will not struggle in the land. The Bible says, the land that flows with business and having, they will not struggle in this land. It's a land of opportunity. But when they are following the God of their father, the God of their father will make sure they are blessed. We want to pray that, oh Lord, the blessings of divine favor will be upon them. The blessings of divine favor, they will not struggle to shine. They will not struggle to sow. They will not struggle to be a bride. They will not struggle to be the star. They will not struggle to be great, because our fathers, their fathers, their mothers are praying for them. We want to pray that, oh Lord, make them great in this land of God. Make them great in this land of God. Make them great in this land of God. Prophesy unto your own children. They are going to be great in this land. They are going to excel in this land. They are going to be crapless in this land. Their place will be at the mountaintop in this land. Their place will be the place that they are going to be the oracle of God, the glory of God, the icon of God in this land. Oh Lord, we pray that you will make our children sad. They will not miss your blessing. They will not miss your divine blessing. And Lord, these children with long life will satisfy them. With long life, they will satisfy them. We will not bury our children. With long life, you satisfy them. They will outgrow us. With long life, you satisfy them. Let's prophesy unto these children. These are your children. Prophesy unto them. With long life, Lord, you satisfy them. Their place will not be in the long-term facility. With long life, you satisfy them. Their portion will not be a terminal illness. With long life will satisfy them. Just command the blessings of God upon their life. With long life will satisfy them. Their life will not be cut short. Their star will not be dimmed. They will not be hit by any stray bullet. In the mighty name of Jesus, with long life will satisfy them on this land.
Satisfy them with long life. In the name of Jesus Christ, who not take care of them, O God, in Jesus' name. I watch over them, O God. I pray, my God and my Father, your divine protection, your divine security, let it be sure by them. Watch over them for us.
We shall not be unfortunate in this land. It is time for prayer, and prayer for our children is a serious time. They will not be unfortunate. Your own child, she will not be unfortunate. That son of yours, she will not be unfortunate in this land. That daughter of yours, she will not be unfortunate in this land. They shall be for signs and for wonders. For the children that the Lord has given you, for the children that the Lord has given me, they shall be for signs and they shall be for wonders in this land. In this land, no other land. In this land, when they are not, they they call themselves minorities. No, we don't care. In this land, they shall be for signs, and they shall be for people who behold their life, and it's like, this is a wonder to behold. This is a wonder to behold. Lord, do it in the life of my son. Do it in the life of my daughter. You can pray better, mom. You can pray better, dad. Pray for your own child. In Jesus' name we pray. We want to pray for the rest of this year, especially this summer. None of them will be admitted at the hospital. None of them will break their bone. Even as they go out and they play on the field and all these other things, the Lord, the seal of heaven will be upon them. Let's call upon the name of the Lord. The blood of Jesus will be a seal upon their life because they are children of covenant. They are minors of covenant. Let's pray that, oh Lord, the protection of heaven will be upon them. The presence of God will be upon them. None of them, we say again, they shall not be unfortunate. They shall not be infected with any sickness. The Lord will preserve their going out and their coming in. And wherever they will be, the presence of God will be with them. In Jesus' name, we pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you because you have always reminded us that you are a covenant-keeping God. You are a covenant-making God. You are a covenant fulfilling God. And tonight you want to transcend, you want to transmit, you want to pass on that kind of valid and unbreakable covenant to our children. We pray, oh Lord, every covenant that you have with us, every covenant of peace, every covenant of mercy, every covenant of salvation, every covenant of longevity, every covenant of prosperity that you have for your church. Oh Lord, we pray, Lord, transmit it unto our children in Jesus' name. We pray that, Lord, all the children that you have given us, they shall be for signs and wonders. They shall be they shall be pillars polished after the similitude of the Father. Their place will be in the kingdom of God. They will follow the God of their fathers. They will follow the God of their mothers. They will be found in the kingdom of God. Their names will be written in the book of life. They will serve this God that we have served. They will worship this God that we have worshipped. They will work for this God that we have worked for. They will serve this God for the rest of their life. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray, oh Lord, these children that you have given us, Lord, they will not be missing in the kingdom of God. They cannot be candidates of hell. They cannot be candidates in the kingdom of darkness. We pray, oh Lord, we seal them up in the kingdom of God forever in Jesus' name. Amen. As many who have traveled to the far country, as many who have just gone out of the far country, and they said that my mom cannot catch me there, my dad cannot catch me there, I'm far away from them. Oh Lord, we pray right there in the far country, you will bring them home, you beckon them home, you fetch them home. And we pray that, Lord, the grace of God will perform a miracle of salvation and a miracle of consecration in their lives in Jesus' name. Lord, wherever they are, whether across the Atlantic, right there in this land, we pray in the mighty name of God, you will place a seal of covenant upon their life. They shall be covenant children. The devil cannot touch them. They will be the apple of God's hand, because the Bible said, touch not my eye, not do my prophet to them. They shall be your eyeball. They cannot be touched by the devil. They cannot be touched by the world. The systems of this world cannot influence them. They shall be great in this land, and they shall fulfill destiny in Jesus' name. Pray, oh Lord, that none of them will be unfortunate. None of them will go to hell. None of them will be missing in the kingdom of God. Amen. Their place will not be in the long-term camp. Lord, we pray with long life, all these children, who will satisfy them in Jesus' name. We will not bury any of these children. Amen. They will outlive us. You will satisfy them with long life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And we pray that, Lord, the places we couldn't get to,
yes, Lord,
the covenant benefit we couldn't see,
yes,
the places we couldn't reach, the souls we couldn't reach, we pray, oh Lord, through these vessels, through these minors, through these children, you will expand the kingdom of God, and you will reach out to God, to the unreached, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Pray, oh Lord, that, Lord, we will nurse them by our side. We will see them every day. And whenever we see them, we will see them. There shall be a source and a channel of blessing unto us, oh God, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We thank you because we know you have answered.
Thank
you have brought
Lord.
Your word tonight, and we know that you brought it so that you fulfill it. We pray, Lord, fulfill it in the life of our children in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We thank you because we know you have answered. We
thank
give you
Lord.
All the glory tonight, dear Lord.
Hallelujah.
For in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
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 And that blessing will be permanent in our life, in our family, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Before we go, we just want to remind ourselves, tomorrow, we'll be having a prayer meeting by 8 a.m. Then by 10:30 a.m., our workers will be having workers meeting by 10:30 a.m. It was announced that it's going to be in person, but it has been changed to online. So please, all our workers, by 10:30 a.m., we'll be having our workers meeting through Zoom. 10:30 a.m. Please, let's all take a note. Let's share the grace and fellowship together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
The love,
the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Goodness and mercy
shall follow us all the days of our lives. Amen.
And God bless you.
Amen. You too.